Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgenwortel, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles. They're not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come on top of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today, we will have a prayer by Todd Chinook, and that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be Romans, the first chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Let's all bow our hearts and minds for a moment of prayer. Abba Yahweh, we come to you again on another night, and we ask for the power of your only begotten Son, Yahshua, to rest upon us, to help us learn, and to remain being faithful to you and to your purpose, pattern, and plan. We ask these and many other things in your only Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's not a failing man. He's not a
Good evening, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Romans, the first chapter, page 201, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Romans, the first chapter, page 201. Saul, a servant of Yahshua the Messiah, called to be an apostle, separated unto the glad tidings of Yahweh, which he had promised afore by his prophet in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior, who was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of Yahweh with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also called of Yahshua the Messiah. To all that be in Rome, beloved of Yahweh, called to be sons, grace to you and peace from Yahweh our Father, Yahshua the Messiah. First, I thank my Elohim through Yahshua the Messiah for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For Yahweh is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making request, if by any means now at length I may have a prosperous journey by the will of Yahweh to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was hindered hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other nations. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the other nations, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah, for it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jews first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of Yahweh revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of Yahweh is revealed from heaven against all impieties and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew Yahweh, they glorified him not as Elohim, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible Elohim into an image made like to a corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore, Yahweh also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of Yahweh into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. For this cause Yahweh gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the nature, the natural use, into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lusts one towards another, men with men doing that which is indecent, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their errors which was proper. And even as they did not like to retain Yahweh in their heart, in their knowledge, Yahweh gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not proper, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, licentiousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of Yahweh, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covetous breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of Yahweh, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but consent with them that do them. I have read Romans, the first chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Reiser, and thank you, Todd. Today is Thursday, and tonight, on Thursday nights, we open up the floor for testimonies. So at this time, if anybody would like to give a testimony, then let us know, whether in the room or out in Zoom. If in Zoom, unmute yourself and let us know, and I'll give you a moment. For that. It's always awkward. Okay. So, for our first speaker, since we don't have any testimonies tonight, I would like to call back up to the floor Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Again, good evening, class. It's a pleasure, it's an honor to be here tonight, and I'm really thankful that Yahweh has given us all a sound mind to be in the greatest place, that if everyone knew, this would be it in this gospel. Yahweh has been placed on my heart different things, and mainly I can say right now that I'm just really feeling, and I can't say feeling, but knowing, to be grateful for what little, even though I may say I don't know that much or what I do, but that is not the point that lifts me, my soul, up. It's what I know for an surety that Yahweh has shown me. And first of all, I mean, I didn't know anything about the names. And the names is very important. And I have come to find out in talking with other people that, in fact, they're teaching me about Christendom, because I didn't know that. They really did. I thought it was just the Catholic people that did the Trinity type thing. But really, it's like the Protestants, the Baptists, they do go through this Trinity, that the Holy Spirit is really something different. They would say, like, Yahweh, Elohim is really not, but God, Lord God, or Yahweh, Elohim. And it's like Jesus is like a float. And this is, I would have to deal with my relatives probably, because now I want to know, what do they know Jesus to be? You know, how do you explain the Holy Spirit? You can tell me that the Holy Spirit did this, and that's fine and good. But it's like now I can connect it to what you say happened, then I want to know, well, how is that? You know, and it's a blessing that Yahweh has shown us, that him taking on a shape and form, this super incorporeal shape and form as Elohim. And Elohim is these nine divine attributes. I have been listening to different tapes and classes. You guys, I got to get my thoughts together. because today has been a day that I have come to realize that it is by faith. Where's this in my book? Sorry. It is by faith. And I do believe I had a conversation with someone. And irregardless to what Yahweh has manifesting in our lives, we have been given the tools. We have been given the instruction that we can see the purpose and pattern and plan that Yahweh has set up. He did this. He's entertaining himself. And he's carrying forth this whole purpose. Now, because of the way that Dr. Kinley did bring it down to us, with the showing forth the pattern correlating with the body, the attributes, the creation, the threefoldness of the migratory tract. That is, and also Isaiah 8:20, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, there's no light in them. Now, I'm going to say with Christendom, they think that this word is in the book. But what they don't understand or know, this is where we're so blessed, is that Yahweh, out of his pure spirit state, took on a shape and form of a man, the superincorporeal shape and form. This is his title, Elohim, but this is also Yahweh manifesting. John 1:1. John. So here we're going to see what the word really is.
John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word.
Right.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Right.
And the Word was Yahweh.
Right. See, like I was saying, this Yahweh in his pure spirit state, we can't understand. He took on a shape and form, a superincorporeal form of a man to do his work. This is Yahweh's working clothes, if you want to put it that way. This is the Word. From this word, every word came from it. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by him.
All things were made by the Word.
And without him was not anything made that
That's
was
right.
made.
That's right. Because if it was Yahweh that made it, you wouldn't know it. You wouldn't know it because Yahweh has no descriptive shape or form. Right. So for the mercy of, you know, of how he made man, then he broke it, gave us another gift, which was himself, his son, or the word or son. That we may be able to take this word, that everything was made from this tabernacle or threefold pattern, as you will see right here, as I demonstrated over here. This is this tabernacle pattern that he told Moses to build in the wilderness. Now, this tabernacle, really, that is Elohim. These people are around because every vessel that's in this tabernacle represents these nine divine attributes. You just got a different shape and form. Everything that you see, literally, I mean, it is Elohim. It's, where was I? I lost my thought.
And pattern.
Yeah. These nine divine attributes, they are in a concrete form. And it was, I didn't get it when Joe used to talk about it all the time, that there's no such you and a Yahweh.
Right.
You know, and I'm going, okay. And so what do we got here? And I finally understood when it was explained to me. And that's another thing, too. This is why it is by faith that we know anything. This is by the grace and mercy of Yahweh that we know anything. Because we cannot see the truth. We cannot see Yahweh. It is by His mercy, His grace. He's controlling everything. That is a hard thing for a man to understand, that He does not control a doggone thing. Even though we've been in these bodies all this time, we've gone through all this experience that, yeah, we were really fooled. We thought we were doing something. And I get so accused of, I'm using Yahweh as an excuse. I say, that's the best one in the world I can think of. And He will always be that. I'm sorry. I will give Yahweh the glory. Good, bad, or indifferent. That's what keeps my head straight. And yeah, don't get twisted, you know? Because I have run into some people, believe me, who, where is that in Matthew, the fourth chapter, when Yahshua went, after he was baptized by John, and went into the wilderness and tested of the adversary? And you know what? That boy, bad boy, I have met individuals like that. They will come to you and tell you what greatness that you can have, how this can be. No, don't tempt me like that. You know, that it's not all about that. It's not about the fancy world and seeing the beauty of Yahweh out there in the world. Not for me. I know it's beautiful. But if I need to be stabilized somewhere, I don't want that. And it's hard for some people to really catch that I'm not a partaker in this world. I can care less. Yahweh has killed those things in me. When? I don't know. But I know He did, because I once wanted all of it. And sitting here in this seat, Yahweh, not me, what I did was pay attention. And even at some point in time, no, I didn't. But I was doing what I thought was the will of Yahweh. And in that, Yahweh knows how to pierce through this carnality, or this head that we got here. And He's showing that we have a free gift. Funny that this scripture, I was reading it today, because I'm starting to go through and read, because I'm knowing that what we talk about here, when I get over into the prophets, I'm going to find something that's going to indicate that I may read it here, but it was here first. This is what they're talking about. I need that information. That is solid. I believe it, and I can hear it, but I need to have it to where not I need. This is what Yahweh will do. This is what Yahweh will do. Because he wants us to teach, whether or not on this floor, whether or not at home, spread the truth, speak this gospel. And I was told, hey, we should be preaching this gospel as if it's our last time. Mm-hmm. Because really and truly, we don't know. We don't know. Yahweh is judging the heart and mind. I know I read up here where it said, for the wrath of Yahweh, it say, shall be revealed from heaven. No, it is. Yahweh is revealing it already. The consciousness, things are happening already. You know, and with all this killing off of our flesh, just like these children, they had to go through, they were here in the wilderness. They got up to the River Jordan because they were they didn't believe the report. Then Yahweh, hey, that's where they died off there, but it was the offspring that went over. The same for us. Our old got to die off. And the understanding, the wisdom, the knowledge, the love, the justice, you know, what Yahweh has given to us to understand his son manifesting, doing his will, that we may be partakers of that calling, of that eternity, or knowing the immortal glorification. Coming over here, the things that we have come to know, those are that knowledge help take off those concepts, those opinions, those theories. That's like when you got that off, you know, you can start to see that you have a soul. This is not you. You know, we're housed in these things, you know. And when I be talking to myself, that's why it be so evident. Because I talk to myself and it's beautiful because I don't go nowhere. And Yahweh said he will abode in the cloud above the mercy seat. Where does it say that, you know ye not that ye are the temple of the living Elohim? And we are not our own. That's Yahweh taken. He is control. We are really his offsprings. I forgot where. And then too, I think Ephesians got some good stuff in there about the temple too. Know ye not that your body is the temple of the living Elohim? How many times have I in my life thought of myself being as such? And that's the real deal. I didn't know that. That is a total different way of thinking. That you are the temple. Yahweh abides within you. And that is a hard thing, but we've got to accept that. Because there's nothing else that we could be. We can manifest something else. Go ahead.
1 Corinthians 3:16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of Yahweh, and that the Spirit of Yahweh dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of Yahweh, him shall Yahweh destroy. For the temple of Yahweh is holy, which temple ye are. Let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seemeth to be wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may be wise.
That's right, because the only wise Elohim, our Savior, is through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign. We are not, these personalities, these things, you know, it has been, Yahweh is a genius to have planned, purposed, and carried out such a master thought, to have hid himself, if I can put it that way, and then to have me to go through what they call life, not seeing Yahweh or Creator, and have me to come and sit down here and give me the greatest gift that anybody could ever have, and that is to know where you came from, who created you, why He created you, and He loves you. Have mercy on you, that we not just only is His offspring, is His bride, His woman. That is us. We are the sons. So we can describe it however it fits. Clothed in the sun, that woman. And He used different women for principles to show for, not just, like you say, this is not just the new covenant. Was not just for the Jews. It was for everybody. He poured out His Spirit. He will save everybody. It is for everybody. So they were only a type back here of the laws that was that they had, was governed by. And us in this day, we got our natural laws, but I've had mine too. The ones, and I think here in Romans, it talks about the law of sin and death. Let me see where it was. It talks about how Abraham, about circumcision and uncircumcision, and that the promise was given to Abraham even though he was not under the law. So if He gave it to Abraham and He had promised Abraham, and Abraham looked forward to it. He believed Yahweh. He gave Abraham that promise without, and it just went all the way down to where they established it as law. Yahshua came in to fulfill that law, and that's over in Jeremiah where we don't do it physically, because Yahweh has written it in our hearts and mind. And this is where I was saying, I be in connect with the soul. The soul represents Elohim. What are we, spirit, soul, and body? Mm-hmm. So Yahweh has laid out so much for us to check out and to really see for ourselves and not for anybody else that this is true. And this is the only truth that I have ever heard of. And I really and frankly don't believe. I don't even need to say it. There ain't nothing else. It isn't. Yahshua has proved all the way down the line who His Father is, what His purpose is. There's nowhere else it's going to be done. That's hard for people to have to. They can't handle that. You can't tell me that you the only one got the truth. Oh, yes, I can. Yes, I can. And I do. Because it is. This is the truth. And that's all we have is to speak the truth. Mm-hmm. And when we speak the truth, and Yahshua, you let him guide you. Be totally surprised how things will turn out. I have to do this with my daughter a lot. Don't worry about it. Just do what he said to do. Just go on. And she can see for herself, oh, our thoughts are not like Yahweh's thoughts. Totally. No, it's not. Right. That's why it's good, in a sense, to stand still and do like he did with the children. When he raised and moved, you move.
Right.
When he comes in the boat, if I can put it that way, or get your attention, then you move. You follow it. That's walking and talking in one with Yahweh through his son. This is his son. Right, look. When he came, poured his spirit out on all flesh, that was him. That was him. And it's hard to believe who we are. But we are powerful. You know what? It is beautiful how Yahweh has allowed this handful of people here to continue. You know, there was one time we had, what, a couple of years ago or whatever? And it looked like, wow, we're not going to have no class. Just keep on going. Keep on going. The doors are not locked. Keep on going. And sure enough, there's love in this class. We all are apprehended by the same spirit. That spirit that is in you is in you, 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 you. We all are apprehended by the same. If you would notice, sometimes if we would talk or don't talk, we, a day or so, the same subject will come up that somebody mentioned over here before. Some classes will go on and talk maybe about circumcision or Yahshua on the cross. Come to class a couple of nights later, that conversation is coming up. That's a oneness. That is Yahweh running this whole show. There's no way man can think of that or tune in and say, okay, well, Springfield, you're going to talk about this. Okay, Ontario over here. No. That is not of no man. This teaching is not of a man. Though Yahweh manifested in the man, he would tell you that. And that's what he wants us to become conscious of and aware. I have listened to some of his tapes, and he can say some words that just... But you know, when you don't catch all of it, but then there's something that's be striking to my ear. Like, that really makes sense. Immortality. And he goes, you're not going to be in Yahshua. You're not going to be in eternity. You are there now. Mm-hmm. And now you should just go by my ear, but go by my head. But no, the man said now, take a look at it. If he said now, that is exactly what's going on. It's my little finite mind that's not taking it serious. That's what he said. So check it out. And that's what I do. That's what I do. Yeah. It's amazing how Yahweh is working his work. I'm enjoying it. You know, he has enlightened me about something. Because there's times, I mean, really, I be looking forward to coming to class. Not that I'm going to get on the floor. I don't care. But I know Yahweh is going to feed me some kind of way, show me some kind of nugget. To me, that is beautiful. That's love. You know, at one time, I got to admit, I wasn't even there. But it's real. That's what makes it, you know. And it wasn't nothing that we are doing. Just following the command. What is that they always say? He say, you take one step and, hey, he'll take you the rest of the way. No, just be obedient to your talk. Just go ahead. I got it. Knowing. He do. He knows every intent, every thought. That could be scary. You know? You know? Because I had a few demons that be, man, they do. Let me quit. But Yahweh, I, Father, I really am so thankful, you know, that my life, if you want to say it, is in you. You know, it's a freedom that he's given to us, and it's time for me to really embrace it. Now, how Yahweh will show us, I have no idea. But I do not put anything past him. He's totally amazing to me. So I just trust and believe, and I know he's there. And I'm listening, you know. But I thank Yahweh for it all. For you guys, hey, let me tell you, I have taken some flack about you guys, but I lived through it. You know, you're supposed to be persecuted. You're supposed to go through all this. Okay, well, dude, you know what? Yeah, I love you. Yep, I do. And my man gets mad because I say, I only got one man. Mm-hmm. And that is the truth. I will serve Yahweh. I will embrace him over anything. And I just pray that he keeps my mind, my heart sound, open. And whatever he sees in me that is not pleasing to his sight, take it. Take it. It ain't mine in the first place. It's just part of what it is to reveal to me Yahshua. It's a loving story. So with that, I'm going to thank you for your time. And praise Yahshua.
Thank you, Dr. Reiser. For our next speaker, I would like to call Dr. Aaron Alanese.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It's always a pleasure to and honor to talk and to share anything that I've come to learn. Not even just standing up here on the floor, but even the conversation that I had before class in my room, that was like a mini class in itself. And that's actually why I was late. But to see, I was spending time with Yahshua, and it was great watching him work. I have never been able to sit and talk with my brother Ethan about these things. And a question was brought up about Noah to us. And it started off just a little slow. And then by the time, though, we were in it, man, we were both in it. Where if I was forgetting a little something, before I could even think that I was forgetting it, he was right there. Boom. And I was just like, Yahshua? What's up? So, man, that was, to experience that outside this classroom, it only makes it more of an honor every time, like how Eunice was saying. I thoroughly enjoyed the first speaker. Where's the first speaker? Okay, cool. Making sure. Yeah, see, I was making sure. But I thoroughly enjoyed Eunice and everything that Yahshua had said through her. It really has been touching with a lot that's been on my mind lately, and what I've been shown and studied lately. We are not in control of anything. You're 100% correct. And yes, I even admit, I am probably one of the hardest headed people that I know. Yeah, they agree. Yeah, a little. You want a mic? I did. It's all right. But it's true, though. It's very, very true. So, for... That got me off a little bit.
You're talking about we're not in control.
Yeah, we're not in control. And it's very hard, as Eunice brought up, for people to understand that. Which would answer the question, why are these stories even here? Why did Noah get put through what he got put through? Why did Moses get put through what he got put through? They didn't know what was going on. They weren't doing it of themselves. Why did this happen? To give you a better understanding of that which you cannot understand, but through love and sacrifice have been gifted a microcosm of the macrocosm that is Yahweh and the universe. Because you can't look anywhere outside of you nor inside of you and not see Yahweh. I believe it's Thessalonians 2nd chapter.
First where or second?
2 Thessalonians 2nd chapter.
Do you want to start at 1?
Yeah, it's somewhere in there about not being deceived.
3.
Yes.
2 Thessalonians 2 and 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first.
Mm-hmm.
And that man of sin be revealed, son of perdition.
Be revealed. Let no man deceive you. Right? Because why? Because there is a way that seemeth right to a man, but the end of there is death. Just like Eunice was saying about these different religions, they think they have it all right. They think that they have it all figured out. Even scientists and all these earthly people of the earthly things think they have it all figured out. Let them not deceive you. Because as quick as you can breathe, blink, or do anything, they will try to deceive you and make you believe that which you are not. Make you believe that you need something outside of yourself. Because they're afraid. Because that satanic spirit is afraid, trembling in his boots, will not deny that Yahweh exists. Look at it. It's in the scripture that not one single time did he deny the existence of Yahweh. When he was in the garden, he didn't go after Adam because he was afraid, because Adam was filled with the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit.
He was the same one that kicked him out of heaven.
So he went after the one who he could deceive and to suppress that thought and that knowledge. Now, sin was brought into this world by a man. Where's that at? Let's get that. Was brought into by the man, or a man, Adam.
Yeah. Is that Acts?
Romans 5 and 12, wherefore, as by one man sin entered.
There it is. Ah, okay.
Romans 5:12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world.
Or Adam, by one man, Adam, sin entered into the world. So before then, there was no sin in the world. Go on.
And death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
So death passed upon all men. Because why?
For that all have sinned.
Continue. For until the law, sin was in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Continue.
But sin is not imputed where there is no law.
Let's look up the word imputed real quick. Because I had to look it up when I was reading that. I believe it was imposed, right?
Impute, verb, from Merriam-Webster Online. To lay the responsibility or blame for something, often falsely or unjustly. Two, to credit or ascribe to a person or a cause.
So let's read that one more time. Not the definition, but the back in Rome.
But sin is not imputed where there is no law.
Continue.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam.
Nevertheless, death reigned. Go ahead.
From Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression.
So even the ones who were not there to sin or to bring that sin into that world were subject onto that sin because we all died in Adam. Spiritually, consciously. Mm-hmm. Because until from Adam to Moses, death reigned. Mm-hmm. The world was not thinking spiritually at all. Which is why it was pertinent to give them something physical. To give them a little bit of hope and understanding, because that's their mindset they were in. They were subject to it, just like the instance of when they were subject to the same darkness and enslavement in Egypt. Now, back at...
Do you want to finish what you had in 2 Thessalonians?
Yes, that's where I was, back at Thessalonians, because until it is done away with.
So, let no... I'm going to start back at 3.
Okay.
Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. And that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called Elohim.
Now that happened in the angelic creation. When Lucifer, the angelic transgression is pretty much what it was referred to, is when Lucifer began to, or not began to, he thought, and in his hearts of hearts, that he was it. He was above Elohim. Mm-hmm. That's what this is referring to. Let's read it again.
Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called Elohim.
Because there was a war in heaven. Oppose is another word for war. He was opposing him. He was trying to be opposite, thinking I'm better than you. I can beat you. Go ahead.
Or that is worshipped so that he as the might... Or that is worshipped so that he, as the Almighty, sitteth in the temple of Yahweh, showing himself that he is the Mighty One.
So he allowed that to happen so that he could show his power. The same that he allows the ignorance to be upon us so that he can reveal himself to himself and show that power. Now, at any of those times, was it talking about any man as far as a human being doing any of this other than this? Let me think where I was going with that. Sorry. This was all Yahweh purpose and doing. Mm-hmm. We are not in control of anything. When Noah warned the people of the coming flood, and they were sealed up, and people lost their faith and the belief that in what Noah was saying. So it was only Noah and his family, the eight souls, and then the animals that were sealed in this ark. Noah, his family, nor the animals, closed that door.
Right.
It was the Holy Spirit. When the flood started, and these people were banging on the door, let me in, let me in, let me in. Noah had no choice in the matter. Was not up to him at all what was going to happen. All these people were telling Noah he was wrong. They were trying to deceive him. And he merely believed and kept going forward. He did not know the reason why he was doing these things, but kept, I'm going to keep going. There's obviously people here helping me build this ark. There's something should be happening. The animals are here. I'm going to keep going. And that's who was in the ark, sealed up and kept safe. Elohim, mm-hmm. The ark type, a type of an ark, a boat type. No one can make you believe what is said down here, what is said about this. It is your choice to believe or not. But I will tell you this, those who believe will be sealed in Yahshua. The archetype original pattern, your only hope of glory. The only one who will give you peace when the storm hits. And you must be in Yahshua like Noah was in the ark. Because we are in Yahshua and Yahshua is in the Father. And the only way to the Father is through Yahshua. The true intercessor and the only way.
That's right.
The way, the truth, and the life. So that's what I can understand when Eunice says how people call this life, because she has an understanding what the life really is. Can no one deceive her like that with that trick? And that's the beauty of all of this, is the ability to not no longer be deceived, to have the veils rent from in front of your face, and to actually see Yahweh as he truly is and actually exists. No other way. We tried. The human race tried to do physical things and save themselves. And Yahshua let them struggle with it. The entire, let them do it. So that he can show his power, come down and show that he himself was the only one who could fulfill and do anything that was instituted by him. Mm-hmm. He set it up from eternity. Describe it to his team, pretty much. And then started the fulfilling of it all. It's almost like a construction, construction plans, if you will. There is an architect, someone who comes up, or there's someone who comes up with the idea, someone who draws it out so the rest of the people can get it, and then it's all put into motion. The blueprints.
There you go.
Or a pattern. Right? That's all a blueprint is. It's a pattern to follow. Now, all we're telling you down here is this is the original pattern from which every pattern is derived.
Right.
So why would you look at those other patterns and not go to the source of where those came from? You want to go to the trickle down. You want to believe these scientists, these smart people of the world who want to say, here's some fossil records. Here's some carbon dating. Have you gone through those things? Mm-hmm. Have you gone through the carbon dating files? Have you gone? But you want to believe them? But it's so hard to come down here and believe something that's said. When we give you proof, make the connections, take understanding from what we've been subject to in the world, brought it in and gave it meaning. Yahweh gave it meaning, not us. We had no choice to come in, but come in here. We were called into here. It's no accident. The name in our foreheads, in our hands, it has been there. It was set up that way.
Yep.
You were in the book from the beginning. He knows you by that identity that you go by. Aaron Alanis, Todd Chinook. But he knows your true name. and that true name can't be taken away from you. Lest anyone deceive you, lest you deceive yourself. You are what you've been looking for. You are who you've been looking for. And when the flesh is taken off, that is what remains. Yahshua had some flesh when he came down and tarried on the earth. Or the likeness of it, at least. Mm-hmm. And it was created to be temporary. Because that is not who Yahshua is. Not the flesh. Not right. The physical. He rose a quickening spirit. Eunice said it. We're three. What'd you say? Mind?
Spirit, soul,
and body. Spirit, soul, and body. Right? And it poured himself out, the Spirit, into you, where he dwells. And if he's in you, you're in him, and you're in the Father, and you can't be taken out. You're in it, whether you like it or not. You're in it. Now you can choose to believe it, or you can choose to deny it. Doesn't stop it from being true. That's why you can't do anything with it. Why nobody's been able to come up here and prove any of this wrong. These aren't cleverly devised fables and stories. I've read some cleverly devised fables and stories, and they have nothing on this. You said it. Genius. If that's genius, there genius does not exist the way people think it does in the world. That is pure genius. Pure genius. No fault in any of it. There's no measure. You couldn't even call it a genius, because a genius is actually, there's an IQ scale for all of this, and you can't put Yahweh on a scale. Nope. But I know what you mean, so that's...
Yeah.
But the point is, you're not in control. Yahshua is your only way and your only hope of salvation. Mm-hmm. You are Yahweh. I am Yahweh. If there's any difference between us, it's that I know it and you don't. That's it.
Okay. Yeah.
That is it. And that is why it's important. Why it's dire. Why, whether I was called upon or not, I was getting up here tonight. We must continue to come to class. We must continue to research this thing. We must continue to talk about this thing with anyone who is willing to listen. We must not be afraid. Let no one deceive you into fear. No one, not even yourself. Because your true self won't have it.
Really?
And you're going to struggle and you're going to have that war going on. That opposition in your head. Because it will manifest to physical things. These spiritual things, if you don't nurture it and take care of your spiritual body, it will manifest to your physical body. And when it gets there, good luck. Because if you think it's bad up here, once it's out here, you're already manifesting it. Yeah. Once you already see it coming out, it's harder. Then you got to deal with that you've already done, you've already committed it, and you got to you got all these other steps you got to go through. But the main step, the main focus is Yahshua. And if anything was got out of what I was, that the time that I was up here, all praise be to Yahshua, the Messiah, your only hope of glory.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Alanese. And I just want to say, it is truly a pleasure to watch Yahweh raise up able-bodied ministers in this gospel. So you see us all increasing in knowledge and understanding, and it is truly a great thing. For our final speaker, I would like to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
I said, those didn't hear me on Zoom, that I have a new tool of my repertoire to be able to see the letters that I had never brought out in public before. This is the debut, if you would. Sean saw me. I missed a fit because I couldn't read something. So I had to go get my handy dandy tool that I have gotten. And I wanted to express that I truly enjoyed the two vessels that spoke this evening and the things that they had to share by way of understanding some portion about this purpose, pattern, and plan by which they've endeavored to recite and to deliver unto us in order to have some faith and some proof in that which, as Aaron said, is our only hope and glory and savior of Yahshua Messiah. And they were going into things that it's been on my mind as well. Prophetic, I'm going to want the definition for prophetic. And the things that they were expounding upon. And then I'm also going to want fear in the dictionary, I think, as well. Because of the things that we talk about are unseen things. And we have the scripture reading, which we'll probably divert back to that because it's apropos. And there's something I saw in there that I want to try to bring out and express to why we have to be quiet within our hearts and mind and listen to Yahshua say it and not us say it. Because the things that he is exposing or expressing are invisible. They're not emotional. They're not anything that's carnal or a theory or a concept or corruptible. They're principles, right, that are immortal, are what that's being seen, because we can't see light, certain on the gamma rays, you can't see the light, but it's there. There's sound levels and pitches that you can't ascertain, but they're there. Right. There's air in this room that's there, but you can't see it. It's working its purpose through your lungs, going down, which you have the same principle of the Israelites having had come down, right? In order to what? Come back up and be able to be dispersed and worked around through this holy place in the blood, the oxygen into that blood. It is rotating in and out. So there's a pattern that the two speakers are talking about. And these are pictorial illustrations to elaborate on the same thing over and over and over again. Because as Eunice expressed, that this superincorporeal form known as Elohim, or that word, right, that's not in the book. Now you tell, like Eunice said, it's hard to tell someone that Bible that they have in under their desk or by their bedside is not the word. They're very difficult to tell them this is not the word. That's physical and literal. And what I'm expressing to you, and we're talking about the word here, and we're still pointing to an image that some people still haven't had a clue that is not physical. Yahweh Elohim and Yahshua are not physical beings.
That's right.
They're not moving around like ghosts trying to persuade you and trying to protect you from evil spirits. You follow that? Because Aaron has said, pure spirit is genius, off the scale, cannot be duplicated or matched by anything. The Father lies himself as well. Because what? He was derived and was created, as Aaron expressed. Grab me Ezekiel 14 chapter? Ezekiel I think it's Ezekiel, the 14th chapter. I've created you in the beginning of your ways, in 28, until I found iniquity was found in me. I thought it was 14. Son of the morning. That was another one. Son.
28 and 14.
Morning.
That
one we got it backwards. Yeah.
One second, I'm sorry.
Isaiah 14:12.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah.
Isaiah 14:12.
You got it.
That was Ezekiel. Isaiah. Ezekiel's another one.
Yeah.
14. Ezekiel, there's something else in Ezekiel too, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Precious stone, okay. Was that covered?
Here we go. I got it.
I think it's Isaiah 14:12.
Isaiah 14:12. Mm-hmm. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son mm-hmm. of the morning?
Mm-hmm.
How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations?
Mm-hmm.
For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven.
That's what Aaron was speaking about when we were talking about this 2 Thessalonians, correct?
Mm-hmm.
About that Lucifer mm-hmm. that was set up for a purpose. As Dr. Kinney used to say, hey, for me, Satan is an ally.
Asset.
An asset. An asset, right? Because he knows about what he was set up to do. And for us, he's a hindrance. It's a nuisance. He's anti what we're about. You understand? And we can't make hide nor hair when or what to do. And that's all invisible is what I'm saying. And we don't understand the invisibility of Yahweh. Keep reading down there, son, in the morning.
For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of El.
And above the stars of El. 14. Bleep over me.
I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in mm-hmm. the sides of the north.
Mm-hmm.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
This is what Isaiah, by way of Yahweh Elohim, is saying, that this father of lies is saying. He's going to be up here. right? Mm-hmm. In the Most High, or dwelling in this most holy place, as it were. And then, don't you know it's dark up in here? There ain't nothing to see up in here. It's an imagination that Lucifer thinking he going to find a place up on this, because these angels all around up in here on the ceiling and everything else, mm-hmm. on these curtains and veils. And this dark, and Yahweh placed them there. Because as Eunice said, that this tabernacle is a representation of Yahweh Elohim that had come down and dwell among them. You follow that? This tabernacle pattern that we have, that Yahweh Elohim transformed into, this threefold incorporeal and invisible tabernacle that Moses saw in a vision. Yeah. And we're dealing about invisible things that this tabernacle was, as it was told Moses, to build one exactly like it in the wilderness, and that Yahweh Elohim is going to dwell in the midst of the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. You follow? And you got them on all four sides. You got the north side, you have the east side, the west side, and the south side, according to the tribes that are around this mountain. And we have to understand how this is working. Keep reading.
14th verse. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, 15. Yet thou shalt be brought down to the grave, to the sides mm-hmm. of the pit.
Mm-hmm.
They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee mm-hmm. and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake the kingdoms?
That's what they're looking for down here in Egypt. And this is what people are looking for and asking about, because they're seeing literal physical things. And that's all that that boy was allowed to handle. He was allowed to handle Job, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was.
Do all you want to do with Job. Right. Yeah. Just don't take him out, basically, right? And Pharaoh. He did all these built treasure cities, did all he wanted to do. But you're going to let my people go. There were things that were already preordained by Yahweh, like Aaron said, for us to understand and know about this Lucifer mm-hmm. that was cast out, so we can have a contrast. Because right. when time started,
there
there was no earth.
Yeah. Okay.
There was no world. There was nobody around. Lucifer, as it was shown on this picture, he was in ethereal darkness.
Yeah.
He couldn't touch nothing. He was nothing to get into at that time. That's why I made the statement in the most holy place was darkness. There was darkness here, and there was darkness down there. Which one am I going to do you? He didn't have no power over neither one of them. We give him that power because we're going to get to it. Prophetic. And I want prophetic first.
Prophetic.
Mm-hmm. Definition. From
is
where?
An adjective. There's two definitions taken from Merriam-Webster.
That's
online.
Fine.
Number one.
People don't know what prophecy means. They don't perceive what prophecy means. They don't believe what a prophet is. Anything a prophet is just he just writing it of his own accord. Well, Isaiah the prophet. That's why they used to say major prophets and minor prophets. Because okay. they thought some knew more than others did. Mm-hmm. They don't have an understanding until Doc made a reference. If it's the Spirit speaking through them, it don't matter if you reading Joel or you reading Daniel. But see, a person has to believe that statement, and that statement has to be proven to them, because it's by the divine inspiration of the Holy right. Spirit that's writing through the man.
Right.
Person got to believe that, and that's invisible. Huh? Enlightenment, light, understanding. This is the light of the world. This is what allowed Isaiah, Moses, and everybody else to write anything, even Saul. The inspiration, right? Yeah. To give them the ability to do anything, even to have life right. themselves. It had to be inspired. And they couldn't, and it's, therefore, that's invisible. Therefore, we think it's just Isaiah. We think it's the devil. Don't know nothing about the devil. But we just thinking. We just imagining these things. We're going to get to imagination because we're going to look up the word fear again. Now, everybody know about fear. Keep reading there in prophetic.
Prophetic. Of, relating to, or characteristic of a prophet or prophecy.
Mm-hmm. Or a characteristic of, or a, read it again.
Of, relating to, mm-hmm. or characteristic of a prophet or prophecy.
Keep going.
Two.
Mm-hmm.
Foretelling events.
It's predictive. It's a foretelling of events. You got soothsayers. You got psychics. You got all these people thinking they can foretell and do things and tell things. And it's coming from what? The spirit realm. That's what, that's how they phrase it. The spirit done told me this, or I done seen this. I done feel this. I done perceive this, right? They not knowing nothing, because I don't go to psychics and literally how they are. But yeah, I believe Isaiah's words. Mm-hmm. Gotta think about that. Mm-hmm. I'm one fear. That's enough for prophetic, because that's bringing in the prophecies. That's bringing in the prophets. And and Eunice made the statement, you have to understand it by the law, Isaiah 8:20, to the law and to the testimony, which are the prophets. And if you don't speak according to what they say, there's no light or understanding in you. So we still, I'm talking about another invisible thing. If we run over to 2 Peter 1:20, grab that and go ahead and read the definition for fear.
Fear.
Mm-hmm. Then this is fear. Read.
It's a noun. An unpleasant, mm-hmm. often strong emotion.
Strong emotion, because you're working off emotions. It's not facts, not literal. You're working off emotions. And we know we all get emotional depending on which way the wind's blowing. You can go every which way with that, right? But keep reading.
Caused by anticipation.
Caused by anticipation, an assumption. Read.
Or awareness mm-hmm. of danger.
Or an awareness of some danger, some pending danger, or gloom, or doom. That's what Satan represents. Red devil, horns. Danger. Keep reading.
Two. Anxious concern.
Anxious. You know, we all get emotional. They start having anxiety attacks. They're not sure what's going on. They don't understand the purpose, pattern, plan of nothing. It's just they're in darkness. Keep reading. Fear.
Solicitude. Three. Profound reverence and awe, especially towards God.
Towards God. That's what's in the definition. A reverence towards God. Don't know nothing about God. Don't know his name, surely, because God is a title and not a name. This is a fact. That's not an emotion. But you tell him that's not his name. Well, he got many names. No, he don't.
That's right.
No, he don't. Not in the book, down in that holy Bible you got. And I'll show it to you. I'm gonna want the scripture reading tonight. I'm gonna want keep reading fear, because I see something right now. Keep going with it.
Four. Mm-hmm. Reason for alarm.
Mm-hmm.
Danger.
Read.
Fear is a verb. One, transitive verb. To be afraid of. Expect with alarm. Mm-hmm. Fear of the worst. Two. Mm-hmm. To have a reverential awe of, fear of God.
That's all invisible. God's invisible. God's a spirit, and you can't see spirit. You don't even know how to perceive spirit. Because Doc used to say you don't even know how to ask me a decent question. Mm-hmm. Therefore, how are you gonna be able to begin to perceive spirit unless you have some foundation and understanding?
Yeah.
But keep reading.
Three, archaic.
These are all feared, archaic thoughts. That's fearful to be locked down here with a consciousness of those people during this dispensation, right? Or this dispensation. People have a barbaric way about some things. You go to some parts of the world, they're way back here in a real way. That's just what archaic means. And it's a fearful thing to be stuck consciously about anything back here, right? Because as Aaron said, that darkness, that that died by that first sin of Adam, they all were dead. And some remain dead. You understand? Keep reading fear.
Archaic frighten.
Mm-hmm.
Four, archaic to feel fear in oneself.
Feel fear in you, too. You have an that's something that Aaron was talking about, have the spirit of Yahweh be in you. You have a spirit of fear or an understand or a lack of understanding in you that make you nervous, makes you anxious, makes you have stress, makes you have all the things that you feel is external messing with you, but it's really the information inside you that got you tripping.
That's right.
That got you unsure about who your creator is.
Yep.
Enough of that. That's fear. Now, I like to get what I asked you.
Second Peter.
Uh-huh.
Second Peter 1:20.
Yes.
Knowing this first, that no prophecy.
Now, this is a foundation step. You got to believe this is Peter that was a real man. Right? He wasn't back here with Pharaoh. He was within this fifth dispensation that crossed over because he was an eyewitness. That's what makes him an apostle. You follow, that was with the Messiah here and then traversed this world, if you would, was ushered in the world by what? Pentecost, because this is whom he's speaking. He said, know this first, mm-hmm. read.
That no prophecy of the scripture is of
the
any
prophecy
private.
Prophecy of the scripture
mm-hmm.
is of no what? Private?
Of any private interpretation.
Yes.
For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of Yahweh spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
That's prophetic. That's believable. That's understandable.
Mm-hmm.
That's not blind faith. And we're going to pick that up with John 1:1, understanding how it came to be and what the purpose that they wrote by, as Aaron was expressing, that why they were imposed with these things for some 4,000 years, right? That's the period of time he was talking about, that this death of Adam that died and ran this whole course. Why? For that we now, in the sixth dispensation, are doing what? Repeating the same thing. And for us to be able to see and understand that invisible Elohim. The invisible Elohim, the scripture reading today, Romans 1st chapter, and skip on down to about 20.
20?
I think so. Go ahead and pick it up at 16 first.
16?
Yeah. And then I'm going to catch it on, I'm going to get down around the 21st chapter. 21st verse, I'm sorry.
Romans 1:16.
Mm-hmm.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
Why he not ashamed? This is Saul. He's not ashamed of something because he already had a prophetic vision
mm-hmm.
on the way to Damascus that he saw, was made to see by Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
Didn't nobody tell him to change his mind or preach to him that was out in the blue? And hey, the prophets had already had Pentecost too. Why couldn't the prophets, why couldn't Peter or John, and we went over and told, hey, Saul, man, come on, why are you persecuting us, man? They couldn't convince that man.
Nope.
He had authority to persecute. You see, he over here in this plate, the persecution of the assembly. That's what Saul was doing. You see Stephen down here? His Saul over here somewhere with his garments.
Right.
After they done stoned this guy.
Right.
They couldn't preach nothing to him. But on the way to Damascus, he got pricked. He had seen something. And Yahweh put them scales over his eyes and made him sit for 3 days. It made him contemplate and understand the things that because he knew the law.
Yeah.
To the law and to the testimony. That's why he can perceive and understand. He could perceive because Yahshua made him live it. Made him study it. Therefore, it wasn't a conundrum to him. He was shown how and why by Yahshua the Messiah. That's just a type in the sense. Now, that's just an invisible jewel right there, if you just saw that little bit. But keep reading. You don't have much time.
For it is the power of Yahweh.
See, that's why I say
salvation.
It's the power of Yahweh to make Saul see.
That's right.
And change his name to Paul.
Right. Yeah.
That's the purpose of that. Did Abraham's name change?
That's right.
Why that happened? Did Sarah's name change to Sarah?
That's right.
Or Sarah was a Sari to Sarah?
Right.
Name change? Mm-hmm. There's a purpose for that. But keep reading.
For it is the power
of
Yahweh.
That's all prophetic. Why those things happen. That's not just willy-nilly bamboozle, the drug of the draw.
Yeah.
Nobody's daddy changed Abraham's name. I'm going to get off of that. Keep reading.
Yeah.
For it is the power of Yahweh
yeah.
unto salvation to everyone that believeth.
Everyone that believeth the report and the vision of that. It's the power of Yahweh to be transform
right.
your consciousness
right.
into the understanding of his purpose, pattern, and plan. We're just vessels. Barely able to hang on, if you ask me any other question,
there you go.
To be able to express the things of Yahweh, because it's too much, even for a normal man to pertain. You read the what Doc talks about when he saw the vision, he felt men walking on him.
Mm-hmm.
He couldn't contain all of him. Saul, I believe, talks about there'll be so many books written of him about the proof of him and the witness of him, if thou would just believe the report. But keep reading.
To the Jew first.
Yep, yep.
And also to the Gentile.
Okay.
Or the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of Yahweh revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith.
What was written is prophetic. That what was written is what Yahshua Messiah wrote through men. Just like you hear my voice, it's spirit coming through me to you.
That's right.
But keep reading.
For the wrath of Yahweh shall be revealed from heaven against all impiety.
Where is that at? Up in the sky? Because that's where they look to. That's where they perceive is going to come from when they was down here, when they were coming up. After Yahshua spent his 40 days on earth, they was looking up into heaven. And what the two men told them, why are you all standing around looking up for? See, some people can't comprehend what they was looking up. Why else did it say they was looking up? Because he's showing a principle that heaven ain't up in the sky.
Right.
You follow? And instead, we live, move, and have our being within Yahweh. He's all around. You're not going to get outside of him to look back at him. So why are you looking up? Because he'll come back in like manner. What he did, 10 days later, he came back in like manner within them. By a rushing mighty wind. That's indicative of spirit, not literal.
That's right.
Not physical. You're not going to see no curtains blowing and say, oh, there go Yahweh. It's principle. But keep reading.
For the wrath of Yahweh shall be revealed from heaven against all impiety and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness.
They hold the truth in unrighteousness of that wicked one. By where that wicked one? Because remember in Joel, when he took as Aaron talked about earlier, when he went out into the wilderness after the baptism, he was tempted of the devil, holding it in unrighteousness, trying to tempt Yahshua or test Yahshua. Take that back.
Right.
Can't tempt Yahshua.
Right.
Yahshua the one who created the guy.
Right.
Your child can't tempt you.
That's right.
He can test you. He can test your nerves, but he can't tempt you because you done created it.
That's
Don't
right.
ever let them think they're going to get the best of you, because they come in years after the fact. You
right.
done set them up. You done created them as a type of Yahweh. That's why they can't get over on you. So you see his kid kicking the mama's ass. That's a problem.
Yeah.
They had no discipline. They ain't taught them nothing, right? And so if you teach them, as Yahweh is teaching us, because he, keep reading because he's going to bring it up.
Mm-hmm.
Who hold the truth in unrighteousness? Because that which may be known of
there
Yahweh
we go. Uh-huh.
is manifest in them.
It's manifest in them. It was taught to them. But they didn't know it, as Aaron said, because it was imposed upon them at that time.
Right.
It wasn't for that. He picked them up when he resurrected for what they were supposed to have done back here. Not our situation. Not our get down. Mama used to say, this is A and B. Get, see your way out of this.
Yeah.
Your type of thing, right? Keep reading.
Yeah.
For Yahweh hath showed it unto them.
They done show them. Yahweh done show something unto them that's prophetic. You can't see that. You can't just see what he showed them. You have to listen to what the whole report is. You can't be like microwave and just get. No, you got to pluck the hairs. You got to soak the chick. You got to do things old school with Yahweh. You're not coming in lickety-split unless he just put it in you.
That's right.
You follow? We're going the long way around, if you would. And don't get mad if someone come in and get a penny just because you had to listen to it this way.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Because it's Yahweh's going to move them, but they're going to have the same disposition as you because they know this is a great vision. It's been prophetically proven. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm.
What verse you at?
20.
You keep going. Two more verses.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Yes.
Being understood by the things that are made.
Yes. That's how we understanding.
His eternal power and supernal nature.
The eternal power and supernal nature is invisible.
Right.
You're not going to look at it. You're not going to work up on it. It's invisible. That which you can see, you're not saying with your natural eyes.
That's right.
You're saying with your consciousness. Get it in, give me King James, Eunice, the same verse right here. Keep reading, Sean.
I got it.
Mm-hmm. This is a vision. This is a prophetic thing. You have to have it in your soul, in your core. That's why we say have an open heart and an open mind, because it's going to have to be converted or changed to see and hear what we're expressing. Keep reading.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead,
mm-hmm.
so that they are without excuse.
But without excuse. Without no excuse. Now, when it read out of King James 21st verse.
That was King James. And now 21st King James.
No, we had the 21st verse. Okay. I want it out of the King James, please. Read.
You got it?
Yeah. Because that. When they knew God.
When they knew God.
They glorified him not as God.
They know. How are you going to figure that out? How are you going to figure that out? We read it.
That's right.
Because that when they knew God.
They glorified him not
as
God.
They glorified him as God. But now you're reading this book and this phrase in the King James Version. If you don't know nothing about these names, keep reading. What is this going to say?
Neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination.
They're vain in their imagination. That's why they're not thankful. That's why they took out the name of Yahweh. And they took out the name of Elohim and Yahshua. And that's why the whole world is corrupt. And they're in steeped black darkness, not understanding the thing about what they read and what they have. That's prophetic. That whole book is prophetic. And it's correct, too. But people are just naive and ignorant. Just so much, they can't figure it out. Like, they couldn't figure out that phrase to save their life. Understand it and read it to me in the correct version, if you would, please. Mm-hmm. Understand that there is an Elohim, and that Elohim is Yahshua the Messiah. Read it, and I'll be done.
All right. Because that, when they knew Yahweh.
We can know Yahweh as he truly is and actually exists. Read.
They glorified him not as Elohim.
But we're going to glorify him as Elohim, knowing that that's one Yahshua the Messiah that was raised and demonstrated from the prophetic birth of him before the creation of the world. And I believe that report about Yahshua Messiah or Elohim. Keep reading.
Neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination.
Vain means empty. Vain means ignorant. And it's an imagination that they believe in. They don't see no prophetic report. They're looking at the flesh. Right. That's all they can see. That's all they can chew on is the curd.
Mm-hmm.
They don't see nothing prophetic. They don't see spirit.
That's right.
Read.
And their foolish heart was darkened.
And their foolish heart shall be darkened. If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh, our Elohim, by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love, and thank you to all of our speakers. That will conclude this evening's lecture. We don't have any announcements tonight. So we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.